A very good evening and a warm welcome to each one of you present here for this webinar on river restoration and wetland conservation organized by STEPS Forum, Department of Social Work, Hindustan College of Arts and Science. So once again, I welcome you all for the webinar. I now invite Mr. Johannes Samuel for the welcome address.
A very good evening to one and all present here. I extend a very warm welcome to everyone. It is my privilege to propose the welcome address. I read this quote about from Jeffrey R. Anderson. He says that a river is the symbol of great flow of life itself. And I think this particular quote would go hand in hand with today's webinar as we talk about the restoration of our rivers. And the care of our rivers is not a question of rivers by itself, but of the human heart. So these lines captured my heart, and I think I would like to welcome each and every one of you here with these quotes in our mind as we go ahead to listen on the restoration of our rivers. I take this platform to welcome our Dean and Head, Dr. R. Shakti Prabha, and our resource person for the day, Mr. J. Jayant. He's a social expert, information and communication specialist from the Chennai Rivers Restoration Trust. And he's also a social worker and who is close to our profession. And we are also looking forward to look into how social workers play a major role in the restoration of our rivers and preservation of our environment. We are so glad to have you here, sir. Welcome. And I also extend my welcome to all the participants in this webinar, all the academicians, the scholars, and the students from various institutions and faculty members from other colleges. I welcome you all, and I hope that you have a great session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I welcome Aishwarya for the introduction of the speaker.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Hindustan College of Arts and Science and Department of Social Work, we would like to welcome our resource person of the day, Mr. J. Jayant, who is currently a social expert, information and communication specialist in Chennai Rivers Restoration Trust. It is a trust that has been wholly owned by Government of Tamil Nadu. He is a professional social worker specialized in community development and empowerment, having work experience of 13 years in the fields of CSR, child rights protection, community participation, training and capacity building, emergency preparedness, and resettlement and rehabilitation, which is known as R&R. He has conducted and organized more than 80 training and capacity building programs in the areas of community participation and preparedness. He has involved in the coordination of the largest resettlement and rehabilitation drive and successfully relocated around 16,000 urban poor project affiliated families from Kuam and Adyar rivers. He has completed his bachelor's in commerce, bachelor's in general law, with several undergrad and postgrad diplomas, followed by master's in social work. He has conducted many seminars, workshops, consultations, and trainings successfully. He has also presented many papers in national and international conferences, and he has received several awards like annual excellence awards for his services. We are very proud and glad to have you among us to conduct a webinar on river restoration and wetlands conservation. A hearty welcome from STEPS Forum, Department of Social Work, Hindustan College of Arts and Science. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. It's really a pleasure for me to share my little experience in the field of community development and resettlement rehabilitation. And at the outset, I'd like to thank the Hindustan College of Arts and Science and Department of Social Work for having collaboration with us in organizing this webinar. And very happy to be to know this initiative, STEPS. It is called Support Taken Up for Empowerment of People Suppressed. So I remember my days in social work in Madras School of Social Work. We have a forum called FORCE. It is only for the, I think madam know, it is only for the community development department for specialization we have. It is called Forum for Organizing Rejuvenation and Community Empowerment. So this is by succession it comes actually. Our seniors adopt some slum areas and other project areas where we juniors, we continue to do that. So it is happy to see that STEPS, because every step is a milestone. So I think this STEPS is certainly taken up many, many important steps in the field of development and social work. So doubts that we thank the management, staff and students of the Hindustan College of Arts and Science. And I thank our member secretary, of Chennai Rivers Restoration Trust, Dr. K. Bhaskaran, IAS, so who is heading the CRRT and who instructed us to conduct this kind of community education programs, which we usually do in a very in an outreach way we do it, but because of this COVID situation, we are happy to connect digitally to have this kind of program. And we do this kind of programs with the institutions which are located along Kuvam and Adyar. But this is one such occasion where, so your institution, which is located close to Buckingham Canal and Kovalam Muttukad Creek area, so which will be a very soon a project area of CRRT, where government having a proposal in terms of restoration of the Buckingham Canal and the Kovalam Creek. So the CRRT, so to give a background, the OVO about Chennai Rivers Restoration Trust. So it is a special purpose vehicle which is created by government of Tamil Nadu. So it basically an idea of government of Tamil Nadu, because we, the Tamil Nadu government, is one of the pioneering states in India where we have a vision document. There's one theme which is in the vision document of Tamil Nadu, Vision 2023, is the ecology preservation in theme 8, where it specifically says that the protection of wetlands and conservation of groundwater and rivers and other water bodies and fragile ecosystems in the state have been protected. To meet this end, the even before that, the government of Tamil Nadu have a thoughtful vision of creating the special purpose vehicle, CRRT, the Chennai Rivers Restoration Trust. It is a trust which is created under Municipal Administration and Water Supply Department of Government of Tamil Nadu. So primarily, the mandate of the CRRT is to restore and protect the rivers, waterways and water bodies in the state. To give overview about the restoration activities which have been taken, or there are two projects which are completed, is Adyar Eco Park now, and it is Adyar Creek and Estuary phase 1 and phase 2 is completed and it is open to public. There are two other ongoing projects. After seeing the success of the Adyar Creek and Estuary, the how it restored and how it benefits the overall ecology of this particular area, so the government have instructed CRRT to restore the Kuvam River and Adyar River. So today's presentation, basically I'll be giving a background about the Adyar Eco Park, so that is a restored ecosystem, and how it benefits the citizens of the city, and the ongoing restoration project. Very specifically, I'll be explaining about the Kuvam River restoration project, which we have seen a sizable improvement and we have reached a milestone in it. And the other ongoing project is the Adyar River restoration project. When you look at the CRRT, it is not an NGO or any in few individuals who created the trust. As I said, it is a trust created by government of Tamil Nadu. The trust is headed by the chief secretary of the state, and there are 9 other secretaries to the government: municipal administration, water supply, housing and urban development, environment, finance, highways, public works department, animal husbandry, and the commission of Greater Chennai Corporation. And it is headed by the member secretary, so who is de facto the chairman and managing director of Tamil Nadu Urban Infrastructure Financial Services Limited. It is also a government agency. So it is now the member secretary is Dr. K. Bhaskaran, IAS, sir. When you see the Chennai, so we are gifted with a lot of waterways, water bodies. We could say it's wetland. So wetland is any area where it can be a marshy land, or it can be an estuary, or it can be a lakes or a rivers. So any area which can have a sponge, have a threshold of retaining water is called wetland. So Chennai city have 3 major the waterways, the rivers. So in north you could see Kosasthalaiyar, in central it is Kuvam River, and it is south Adyar River. And all the 3 rivers are cross-cut by the longest canal. It is Buckingham Canal. It is close to 48.5 kilometers in the length. And it is not only these 3 rivers and the Buckingham Canal. There are close to 50 and above drains and natural canals are located in the city, like Oteri Nalla or Nungambakkam Canal or Virgambakkam Arumbakkam Drain. So it is wonderfully, it naturally happened to have a lot of water bodies in the city. So now the thrust on restoring the waterways, mainly the 3 rivers, and continuously the government have a proposal to restore the Buckingham Canal and the canals and drains in the city also. If you look it into the any urban area where the major problem what we see in urban area, it's because of rapid urbanization. So we have a lot of pollution that happens. It is it restricts the water flow and it reduces the carrying capacity of the river. And we have solid waste dumping into it, and there are liquid waste, which that means the untreated water is directly letting into the river. So these are all the issues that commonly seen in the city. So it is not Chennai is not exceptional to that. So wherever there are metropolis, you could see this happens. What is the effect? The issue, certainly the inflow of untreated sewage and disposal of solid waste. As I said, there are informal settlements, so that naturally have taken up the original glory of any waterway. So the government decided to restore initially the degraded ecosystem of Adyar Creek and estuary. So this is basically a part of Adyar River. So the Adyar River, it is close to 42 kilometer length. It starts from Adanur in near Guduvanjeri, just upstream of it, and it comes to the city. And before it reaches to the Bay of Bengal, so it just underneath the Tirivika Bridge in Adyar, the river again takes an U-turn. So that portion is called a creek area. So the river where it goes to sea is an estuarine area. If it's an estuarine area where if it again takes an U-turn, it is in a creek area. So it is not in a freshwater. It is neither a freshwater nor a saline water. It's a brackish water. It's a kind of salinity and the freshwater, it mix up in one particular area. So earlier it was degraded and the government had a plan and prepared a detailed project report. And this they have sanctioned, given administrative sanction and accorded funds to restore this area. So this was earlier condition of this 58 acre Adyar Creek was the first phase one taken up by the government, where as I have given an initial introduction, where any water body is subject to what there are only three major problems that we witness. One is the sewage water and the solid waste dumping and the informal settlements, and there are other the disturbances due to the human activity. So this is before taken up. As per the detailed project report, the government started restoring that Adyar phase one, that creek area. And you could see the aerial view of this area. This is taken before the restoration of it. You could see this is the Santhom Road. This is Santhom Causeway. Underneath this, the water from the Adyar River, it comes to the creek area. So this was only just patches of water that here and there that you could see. It is only 5% of the water was earlier. So this is taken during the restoration phase, where you could see the accumulated solid waste and tens of Prosopis juliflora, all the wild vegetations were clear. And you could see this is taken after restoration of it. So earlier, it was only 5% water spread. That means any creek should have a water flow. That means it is basically a tidal interaction where the water from the river, it goes to sea, and from the sea, because of high tide and low tide, this tidal interaction happens. The water should come to the creek area. So this is the success of this restoration is the water spread has increased from 5% to the 59%. That means it's not only water. When the water comes into the creek area, it brings a lot of organisms. So microorganisms, and followed by that, the ecological cycle is established. The following slides, you will be seeing what is the benefit that is what we are seeing now. So followed by that, the phase two, that is 300 acres of creek and estuarine area was also taken up. And you could see the difference. So this is one area where earlier there was a pedestrian bridge, motorable bridge actually. And so we don't want to cut off that area because this basically connects two different parts of the Mandavali area. It's called Karpagam Garden, where the motorable bridge, which costs disturbances to the habitants, the biodiversity in the creek area, is transferred into a pedestal bridge. Now the meaningful participation with the public can have access, and also the ecosystem is protected. And it is close to 179,000 TDF, the tropical dry evergreen forest saplings, the mangrove and mangrove associates, which are conducive to the coastal vegetation, have been planted and nurtured. And the effect of this is the water quality has improved, and it brings a lot of biodiversity into it, and the habitation of a lot of species. Right? It can be birds or mammals or insects or molluscans. So you could see the whatnot. So all the biodiversity, which earlier was not there, is again, it came back. So these pictures are taken within the Adyar Eco Park. And the Adyar Eco Park is open to public, and close to 1 lakh school children have so far visited, and close to 8,000 interested public have visited here. And you could see what all the benefits and what are the kind of aquatic species that have come back to the creek area. So this, you could have a real-time experience when you visit Adyar Eco Park. So the government school children are taken at free of cost. So the charter trips are made and refreshments are given. And we have our in-house expert, Madam Gomati Nagarajan. So she is expertise in terms of interpreting this, the environmental benefits and how the degraded ecosystem is restored, and how the earlier species have been come up. The earlier it was close to 132 species, and now we could see even 372 the type of species which is reported now. And every week there are 3 days, Tuesdays, Thursdays and Saturday, the public are allowed to visit the Adyar Eco Park, and 20 rupees a nominal charge is even now because of COVID. So we have not allowed people to visiting Adyar Eco Park. When the now we are in new normal, when the old normal comes, certainly you all are welcome to visit the Adyar Eco Park. And because as part of the observation visit, the social work department students from different colleges in the city are visiting the park as part of their observation visit and as part of the environmental the aspect of it. And you can get the details. You can visit our website at chennairivers.geo.in. So where the advisory to the visitors, and it is only a provisional booking that you can do. So there is no need to pay an amount because we restrict the human footprint. So now only 60 people, 60 individual interested individuals are allowed in a day. That means in the 3 days which we allow the public to see, and you could have a direct experience on how the a dump yard is transferred into a wonderful place. It's a hub of biodiversity. And this is an aerial photo. This is phase one. This is Santhong Causeway. You can see this is Srinivasapuram. This is Loop Road, where this is after restoration taken last year, where you see how it got transformed. Still, the transformation is going on, and because any degraded ecosystem to gain its own glory, it takes another 20 years. So we are in the milestone of the 10 years. We could see the difference. Certainly, the days comes will give more benefit to it. So after seeing the success, the government decided, why not? If this is possible, why can't the Kuvam River can be restored? So the government have created a detailed project report and to restore that Kuvam River. And the project is called Integrated Kuvam River Eco Restoration Project. So the Kuvam River, originally it starts in the upstream of Thiruvallur. The length is 72 kilometers. But the restoration what we have taken is only for 32 kilometers. It is just downstream of the Parithipattu Anaikar. It is close to Avadi, where when the river enters into the urban area, in the peri-urban area, the river the evidence of the river got polluted, and that's the point where the pollutants are entering into the river. So the restoration plan, it's basically what is going on now is for 32 kilometers stretch. So how it happens, it is not directly CRRT who implement the entire components. It is close to 60 sub-projects. So government, whenever goes for a scientific restoration of a water body, they'll create a detailed project report in consultation with people and with the technical expertise from the various department. And there are 7 departments which are involved. The owner of the water body is WR, the Water Resources Organization of Public Works Department. So they have been interested with desilting, demarcation, fixing of the boundary, basically to ensure the river channel improvement. That means the river should be in a position to carry water. That means it should have its own right of way. So the PWD is interested with ensuring the river channel improvement component, and the river flows within the Greater Chennai Corporation area underneath the Madurai bypass. It's close to 22 kilometers out of 32 kilometers. And also the river flows in the Thiruvarkadu municipality and Senirkuppam, Adayalampattan, Vanagaram village panchayats. It comes under Directorate of Rural Development. So the ULBs are interested with removal of the accumulated solid waste within the right of way. That means within the river. And they fence this area. Fencing means they built a see-through compound wall, because in any urban area, the challenge is to restore the right-of-way, means restoring the original boundary of the river to secure that river to establish the boundary of the river. So the fencing all along the river is built by the respective urban local bodies. And the major department is CMWSSB, the Chennai Metropolitan Water Supply and Sewerage Board. Because as I said, there are three challenges in restoring. One is solid waste, liquid waste, and removal of the encroachments and relocation of the project affected families with urban poor. So the sewage pollution mitigation is entrusted with CMWSSB. So the project identified it is close to 108 places where the outfalls, because it is the Kuam River, if you take, it is not a perennial river, it is a rain-fed river. So whatever you see, it's a treated and untreated sewage water. So the untreated points where the outfalls which directly comes into the river has been intercepted by a pipeline, and it is diverted into the nearest pumping station. From there, it goes to the nearest sewage treatment plant. Once the water reaches there, so the sewage reaches there, the treatment process goes on. After the water reaches to an acceptable level as per the CPCP guidelines, the treated water is let into the river, so that then it is allowed to move on. And the other department is the most important department, where the social workers have a role, and social workers are sizably contributing, is the Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board. Even I was a trainee during my days in Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board in Community Development Department. And we have a lot of social workers in Community Development Wing, where we are the TNSCP is interested with resettlement and rehabilitation. So that's where, as a social worker, as a social expert in CRRT, my role is to see that the people are seamlessly relocated and the rehabilitation measures are properly taken care as per the detailed project report. And CRRT, we are interested with the, because our expertise in terms of the vegetation, so we are in the process of planting the vegetations wherever the places are secured with the river rain species are going to be planted. And we see the overall monitoring of the project, and we conduct a lot of community education programs. And this webinar, what we do, is also a part of this community education program through virtual mode. So how this happens? So I'm not going to explain about all the technical aspects, because I don't have expertise to tell you how the treatment happens or how the solid waste is handled, because our expertise area is social work. So we work with people and we ensure that the development happens in tandem with the people's requirement, with people's participation. So the process, basically, it is called a lot of R's into it. It is reconciliation, rescue, relocation, resettlement, and rehabilitation, then reclamation of the land where earlier it was encroached or earlier it was occupied with solid waste and other things, then the restoration happens. I'll explain how this resettlement rehabilitation happens. So the resettlement rehabilitation, it is not, we are successful in terms of relocating close to 12,000 project affected families to for four different rehabilitation sites of Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board since November 2016. And we are almost 80% of families have been relocated, and another 4,400 families will be relocated in a phased manner. So how the process happens, because it is very important to understand the process. It is not how the media reports one fine morning, the government officials with bulldozers goes into the houses on the river banks and we knock the door and we ask the people to move out and rush down the structure. So that is not the case. It takes several years to convince the people. So that's where I said the reconciliation. So reconciliation is we have series of consultation, even right from the preparation of the detailed project report, we have a consultation. There's one particular stage is called dissemination stage, where we have stakeholders consultation, public consultation, where we explain the people, the families who are on the within the river banks, because we don't relocate people who are beyond the river, because the river has a right of way and people are literally within the river. That means they are in the river area are only relocated, and the people who are beyond the right of way, beyond the river boundary, they are not disturbed. So that is the basic process. We explain them, we'll go with the revenue officials and PWD, uh-huh, and we'll say this is the boundary, and so we want people's participation, the cooperation in terms of we take several years to convince the people to participate in the biometric enumeration of it. And after completion of the enumeration biometric, only the relocation happens. Why we have mentioned that this is there is a rescue involved in it. And when you look into the Kuam River Restoration Project, it's close to 54 slum habitations, and where 14,257 families have been identified. And we have successfully relocated close to 12,000 project affected families. Where there are notified slums in it, they are the habitants for more than six decades, where the people are not willingly, voluntarily, and they are not being a habitant in that area. There are slum lots. Like, how do we know there are land lots? There are slum lots. There are powerful leaders in the community where they have a mockery. So they have a sizable land, and they let this space to the urban poor, and they collect rent. And naturally, there will be indebtedness, and there will be most of the people are in the trap of in the hands of this slum lots. So basically, it is a kind of a rescue operation where we have to take the people out of the trap of the slum lots, and we give a sizable resettlement rehabilitation package with 400 square feet of a dwelling unit, with a resettlement rehabilitation package of close to 1.27 lakhs to every individual. When you look into the budget, the costing part of it, the short-term restoration cost of the Kuam River for seven departments is 604 crores actually. But the major part the government spends very carefully is for the resettlement rehabilitation. Close to 181 crores is given for the resettlement rehabilitation cost, apart from the building cost. When you look into the building cost, it is another 1,041 crores. The overall cost of it, the government spends, if they don't see the river restoration, the people are relocated for river restoration. So it will be an opportunity for the government to give a decent housing and uplifting the living condition of the urban poor who have been in the objectionable and vulnerable location, because they are the people who are within the river who are living, or the first line of people who affect any extreme condition happens. If any flood comes or any health emergency comes, they are the people who immediately get affected. So we want this vulnerable group, the people who are in a very objectionable location and they are in a very vulnerable area, have been given a proper decent accommodation, and the resettlement rehabilitation happens. So I'll explain this process of how the people are relocated. First, I said the boundary will be demarcated to them, and there'll be a series of consultation to them. And there's a procedure called Form 2, where at the doorstep of the project affected family, it is a joint enumeration. The landowning department is public works department, and the urban local body, the Greater Chennai Corporation, and Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board, with revenue officials, where the every door-to-door enumeration will happen. So the officials, they'll have a form two. They'll capture all the details, and a photo is taken in front of the house to make sure that the person have a structure, who is an habitant of this particular place. And the biometric survey happens. And after that, a date will be fixed. And there are several times the people give a date, and they later resist to move out of this place. They ship from the place. So this is how the process happens. So when you look into it, so this is how this is a place where the social workers are involved, and to get the details of it, because NGOs are involved in capturing this data, and the professional social workers are part of this exercise of biometric, the enumeration of the family. And the biometric is taken with the technological support, where the thumb impression and their photograph are taken, because we don't want any duplication to happen, and the right beneficiary have been captured with the complete details before we get the allotment. Once the allotment is ready, we'll have the consultation with people, and if they said, because the relocation doesn't happen throughout the year, so the relocation specifically will happen in a very specific 2 to 3 months in a year, and not affecting the academic and their livelihood, and in the monsoon time, other reasons are taken care, and government carefully fix up a date. And the relocation means not directly we give allotment orders. There is a camp arrangement is done with all the departments, and their all the basic proofs are collected, and in one umbrella, they get all the services. And the urban local body, they organize for vehicle to ship the family from one place to from the place where they are living and to the resettlement site. It is not one particular scheme area. So there are four different scheme areas where people have been given allotments, have been relocated. One is in Trivatriyur, there's a scheme called AAR Land Scheme, All India Rodeo Land Scheme of Thumb Clearance Board, and Gudapakkam Scheme Area, which is close to Tirumirisai, and Nawalur, which is close to the Padappai, and the largest scheme area is Perumbakkam. So the options are given to the people. There are one slum area in Muthumariamman Koil Street, which is just opposite to D.D. Vaishnava College in Arumbakkam, where the Zone 8, the Annanagar Zone officials of corporations, the zonal team, they have taken the representatives of the slum, the project affected families, and they have taken to all the four locations. So the community splits into two. 156 family, they said, we want to a place which is close to railway station. So they have been allotted in the Tiruvatriyur scheme area, AAR Land scheme area. And a certain group of people, around 250 families, they said that we were originally intrastate migrants, where we want a place like in a rural area typically. So we want to live in Nawalur scheme. So that is how the options are given when the options are available. So the options are given. And this is how the democratic process happens, where it takes time. So it won't, if we fix up a date, it is not on that particular date, it will never happen. So they'll ask for a time, they will bargain it. They say, we have some festival. So why can't you have this relocation after a couple of months after? So that is also being considered. And the vehicle is organized. In vehicle, you don't believe that in many cases, it's only a slum habitation. Doesn't mean that they don't have any the belongings. They have all the costly, home appliances will be there. Only one to two families are accommodated in the huge truck. And even the shifting or the manpower arrangement is done them to shift the belongings. You could see this is a camp arrangement where in CRRT it is close to since 2016, we are fortunate to give opportunity to fieldwork trainees from different trainees from our social work department across the city, and they play a very important role even in the you could see the some faces of the trainees who are the social work trainees of CRRT also being part of this. So this is a place where in one camp their family card means their ration card details are captured, and the school-going children details are captured, and the college students details captured, and there are the people who are already the beneficiary under the triple scheme, social security scheme, where their details like widow pension, the disability maintenance allowance which they get, and in this case we have even close to 26 transgender person is also given allotment. Usually the beneficiary is a family. Only an eligible family will get an allotment, because the unit cost when it was designed, it was 6.5 lakh. Now the cost is 13 lakh is one unit, one tenement cost, apart from the rehabilitation measures. But we consider the transgender person, they are the socially isolated group from the family, from the mainstream. So we even consider a transgender person, if the person is a member of our Transgender's Welfare Board, have a proper valid identity card, membership card, is given allotment. Even that single person is treated as a family, because we don't want them to be excluded from the important activity of resettlement rehabilitation. So government sees this as an opportunity even to give allotment to the individuals like transgender persons. So this is how the camp happens, and the feeding arrangement is done from the date of relocation. Every day, three times a day for a 3 day, food and water is given to the family, and from the resettlement site, from the slum area, and also in the resettlement site, and also the medical team from the corporation health department. So they also part of the camp. So as I said, the civil supplies department, elections department, education department, all the officials of this area, because when they relocate from one area, from Chennai district to, if it is Gudapakkam, it is Tiruvallur district, it is Perumbakkam, it is Chengalpattu district, Nawalur is in Kanjipuram district, Tiruvatriyur is again Chennai district, where the details from the place where they were living, all this data has to be migrated. So this is one area where we conduct one camp here. And after, once they get resettled, the similar camp is organized them to see to that the seamless migration of the data, the civil supplies and other things happens. And in a day, if a slum has 300 to 400 families, it is not one day the entire camp will happen. So it is based on the number of members in the family and the size of belongings that they have, the home appliances and the number of trucks and the distance. Average of 80 family is the highest number that can be relocated in one particular day. And the camp goes on for a week based on the number of families in that area. As I said, what is attractive and why people have shown absolute interest in relocation. So there are a lot of entitlements. As I said, the special camp is organized and the transportation arrangements are made. The government bears the cost and the food and water is given for 3 days, for three times in a day for the project affected families in both the locations. And immediately the shifting allowance is given to them, because basically if a family shifts from one area to another area, the government sees that there'll be an inconvenience. In addition to the transportation arrangement, what we do, immediately a cash benefit of 5,000 rupees is given as a shifting allowance to the family instantly, immediately once they reach the slum clearance board scheme area, and the LED lights of 4 numbers and ceiling fan is given to them. And the other component, which is very important component, is the subsistence allowance. Because when a family is relocated from one area to other area, where certainly there will be an impact on the livelihood. So to reduce the inconvenience, to compensate that loss of livelihood, the subsistence allowance of rupees 2,500 per month for 1 year is given to the family. So this is how the loss of livelihood, in addition to the smaller economic activities and income generation activities we do, the cash benefit of 2,500 is credited to the bank account. Our project management group, who are specifically engaged to implement the resettlement rehabilitation package, they will ensure the project affected family, the families, the urban poor, they have a bank account. If they don't have a bank account, they'll liaison with the local lead bank in the scheme area, and they create a bank account to them and make sure that the amount is get credited to. And the other component is, if urban poor wants to avail a dwelling unit, a tenement from the Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board under any scheme, so the urban poor has to pay 10% of the total cost as a beneficiary contribution cost. So that is the important area, because basically the 90% is backed by the government. This 10% amount the beneficiary has to pay. It is like an equated monthly installment they will pay for over a year. But in this case, under Kuvam River Restoration Project of Chennai Rivers Restoration Trust, the government has even paid the 10% amount on behalf of the beneficiary to Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance. That means the beneficiary no need to pay the 10% beneficiary cost. And any beneficiary who occupies a tenement in Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board, so they have to pay that electricity service connection charges of 2,500 rupees. Even that is taken care under the Kuvam River Restoration Project under resettlement rehabilitation component. And there will be a lot of community development activities, formation of resident welfare association, self-help groups, and income generation activities, and the sports mela and employment related activities, and the job melas what we conduct. So these all the camps which will be conducted under the community development program. And there is a project management group. So the project management group is headed by the community chief community development officer and community development officer and project coordinators, so who are all professional social workers. And they will be assisted by the community, the people who relocate. So we identify animators and supervisors from the beneficiary group. It's an aerial view of Perumbakkam scheme. So as whatever I explained, these are all the benefits that they get instantly and under the resettlement rehabilitation. You could see the cost the government which spends for the resettlement rehabilitation, because it is a dual agenda. It is where restoration happens for the larger interests of the society. At the same time, the urban poor who are in the vulnerable conditions for years together, so they have been given proper resettlement and rehabilitation. So both the purpose are achieved with the people's participation. As I say, these are 4 different scheme areas where our project affected families have been relocated. How the camp is organized in the slum area, in the resettlement area. Similarly, it is also in the scheme area, where the people get their allotment. All the officials are sitting there and they make all the arrangements and all the details are captured. And the allotment, how it is made. If it is Gudapakkam, it is G+3. It is Navalur, it is G+3, ground and 4 floors. In Thiruvatriyur, it is G+3. And in Perumbakkam, it is G+7 with lift facility, with elevators. It is not on a lottery method or any first come first basis allotments are given. Whenever the families are relocated, so they will, our project management group and the slum clearance board officials, they will assist the family. If the family has a person with a differently abled person, or a person who have any chronic medical ailment, or a single woman, you see, all the physical and their social characters are analyzed, and based on this, the slum clearance board, they have a protocol to allot the ground floors and first floor to the differently abled people. And if a person has undergone any surgery and all this medical and the physical condition and are considered, there are certain cases where the single women, they want allotment, they have some neighbor because that's how they feel socially secure, where they ask their family members the allotment of the next door to be given to their family member, to their siblings or a closer relative or in-laws. So where the allotment is made, so that's how the consciously the officials who are sitting in the slum clearance board scheme area, they will allot. So this is how it happens. Now you could see the, how the cash benefit, the shifting allowance is given to them instantly on the day of relocation. The ceiling fan and the lights are given to them. There's a lot of skill development training programs with whatever the skills that are required, the skill trainings on the two-wheeler service and the DTP, and there are eco kitchen, and there are paint academy, color academy of the Asian paints. So they have a collaboration with the CSR, and the training is given to them, and the certification is given to them. So this is how the various the community development activities have been done. This is all customized thing. So whatever they are, in addition to this, we'll assess how what was their earlier occupation, what they were doing in the slum area. If they have doing a small itinerant trader, or if it is they are a street vendor, and if they are doing some tail cutting activity. So we capture all the details of them, and based on that, the assistance is given to them. If there are some cases where they get flowers from the Coimbatore and they sell flowers. So we give 3,000 or 5,000 rupees as an initial investment to them. They'll do it. So that's how, if they run some small idli shop where nighttime, evening tiffin center, all the utensils and other things are given to them under the scheme. So we basically want that they don't discontinue their livelihood. The livelihood is ensured, and because this is not any far away places. It is within 20-25 kilometers within the city, because the city is a very vast area where, but even that should not, because we are all territorial animal, where if they relocate from one place to another place, certainly it takes time to get settled to them. So this is an aerial view of Perumbakkam scheme. So now, as I said, there are close to 54 slum locations. I'll show there are typical slums. You could say this is one area in Egmore, so in Thousand Lights area, Greams Road. So where in Didir Nagar, so there are close to 603 project affected families. Now you could see how congested they are living there. So you could see how congested they are. So in this particular area, close to 603 families. So the government have taken a lot of efforts with the interdepartmental coordination. We convinced the people and we asked them to cooperate, and they have been relocated successfully in Perumbakkam scheme. Now you could see this is taken before restoration. This is taken immediately after. And this is the Co-optex bridge here. Okay. So this is after removal of the CND. So this is widening of the river. Okay. Now this is every time the flood comes, you imagine that the people are literally, the water comes to this level, this road level. So that means the people, all the structures are submerged. There are incidences where the few children were washed away, even they lost their kids even during flood times. So this is how the situation, you imagine how badly they are very close to the river. So because if this is a freshwater river, we have no problem. So because this is a river where we have the untreated water, the polluted water is there. If the people are living very close to that, they have a lot of morbidity. So they are prone to a lot of environmental related diseases. You see, so this is how, this is one area, this is taken after, this is after removing the CND, and so now the plantation will be happening here. Now the river has its own capacity. When the flooding happens, when the monsoon comes, the river is in a position to carry the flood water, to intake the flood water in her own way. Okay, so this is another place in Chindadri Pet, Navalar Nedinjedi and Nagar. So this is one of the scheme areas of Slum Clearance Board. Already in the other side, existing slum areas that you can see from this is just below the, just close to the MRTS station in Chindadri Pet. You see, so we had a good experience here in terms of convincing people in with their cooperation. So we relocate. Now you see the difference now. So this is the original width of the river. People were within the river, you see. So now the bund is formed. So we are not going to construct anything here. So this is only an ecological restoration. The river boundary is established, and there will be a plantation. The riverine plantation, coastal plantation will be happening in this place. This is another place in Pallavan Nagar. There's a slum called Pallavan Nagar. It is behind that Pallavan Illam, MTC headquarters. So this place, it's close to 800 meter length. You could see literally the people are living on the, they are just within the river. So you see, so they, whenever the high tide, low tide happens, because this is very close to that regulation zone, it's just upstream of the Shivananda Saleh, when every 4 hours, the sea water will rise. So it is called tidal, you could see the high tide, low tide happens. Whenever there is a high tide, and in the days like when it is a full moon day, you imagine the water level rises to 3 to 4 feet, where the water gets into the air. This is taken immediately after. So we relocated them. This particular area where the close to 800 families, they asked for, 1,018 families, they asked for particular blocks in Perumbakkam. They asked block number 91 to block number 114. So the then managing director, Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board, is kind enough to consider that, because they lived as a community, they don't want other community to mix in their tenement, in their block, because every block in Perumbakkam has 92 units. It is G+7. So we have given the allotted the entire to accommodate the 1,018 families in the blocks which they were asked. So this is how the government is kind enough to consider the, because we want people to, because if they relocate, it is not relocation. So they have to recreate the habitation, the data. So you could see the difference now. Now the river is in, this is Chindadri Pet railway station. So now you could see. It is not only the families who have been relocated in this scheme, in Pudupet area. So it is known for auto spare parts area, where in Pudupet, in South Kuvam, in Chindadri Pet, it is West Kuvam, East Kuvam. So a road where there are commercial establishment, auto spare parts, small shops, where they were originally given allotment by the government for the Burma refugees to have some shops for their commercial activity on the roadside. Later, the business enhanced, they got into the river. So they are not directly, it is not any enforcement aspect to just give notice and relocate the people. So here, how the families are given housing units, in the same way, the Autonagar, there is a scheme called Autonagar, plots are developed near Waragadam, and close to 458 shop owners are given, 90% of the land cost is given. 350 square feet means it is 300 square feet is bought by the government under the Kuvam Restoration Project. And 50%, 50 square feet of the land, they have to pay in an equated monthly income. That means for the shops, we have given land plot to the shop owners, and they have been relocated. Okay, so now this is before, this is after. This is after means in 2017-18, we relocate them. And this is taken immediately after that. Now the fencing has been built all along the banks to secure that area, and vegetations will be happening very soon. You see the difference now. This is earlier, this is the same location from the same orientation. Okay, this is South Kuvam River. Shops were removed. They have been given plots. So what is river restoration? What we are talking about? Once the people are relocated, when the shops are given plots, allotment, river widening is done, and the bunds are strengthened, and the sectioning is done by the Public Works Department. And there's one component in Kuvam River is a baby canal, because as I said, it's not a perennial river, it's a rain-fed river. This, to avoid that lean flow to stagnate, because when the sewage water stagnate in one particular area, where it'll be a place for the mosquito breeding. So we don't want this to happen. There'll be a small channel like baby canal is formed to facilitate the lean flow of water in the non-season period to flow, not to get stagnant. Okay, so this is the interception and diversion pipeline. Wherever there are outfalls which directly comes, the untreated water are diverted, and they are intercepted and diverted through this pipeline to the nearest pumping station. And once it's treated and it reaches the acceptable standard, it again let into the river. This is another component, because the accumulated solid waste are removed. That is one on the banks. But there are floating waste. So when there is a plastics and other waste which goes to the ocean, so we don't want that to happen. There are in 8 locations in Greater Chennai Corporation area, the trash boom systems are deployed, and periodically it gets removed. Okay, so it is basically arresting the floating waste getting into the ocean, and the fencing is built all along. How this happens from the time of detailed project report preparation till the what we are doing now, the restoration, and even post restoration, we need the community to participate. So this is how it happens, because without their participation, whatever government does, it doesn't make any fruitful result. So there are a lot of stakeholders, like the institutions which are located along Kuom and Adyar River, and the ULBs and the NGOs and RWAs. So they are the important players in it. So how they could participate they can participate in the awareness programs that we do, and they can be a part of our larger campaign. So in a generic sense, when you look into it, there are nowadays, after 2015 floods, there are a lot of groups: Sabari Green Foundation, Selayur Group, Lake Protection Group, and Ambattur Eri Padagap Yakam, Koratur Eri Padagap Yakam. You see a lot of self-interest groups, which are community-based organizations only on the lake the protection and conservation activities going on. And they are spearheading this activity. So this is how the community can certainly be a productive partner in terms of protecting the wetlands, which are very close to it. And there is one incident wherein close to Perungudi Lake, every year they celebrate a lake day. So in that particular day, they invite all the celebrities and nearby communities. You see, so they'll sensitize about the existing water body and how it acts as an important role in the particular area. So this is how the community can participate, and the lot of areas that they can be a player, a productive player, and not allowing that solid waste dumping into that area. And what they do, they can support the urban local bodies in terms of source segregation, in terms of not directly dumping this into the nearest water body or waterway. If any C&D waste, any construction demolition waste is dumped by any particular truck, you can directly escalate this to, you can be a community reporter, where you can call, if it is within Chennai area, the Chennai Corporation has 1913, is the toll-free number where you can inform. So this is how you make sure that your neighborhood, because whatever we do, again, there will be a repeated pollution that happens. So we want the neighborhood, nearby community to be very vigilant in terms of immediately informing this to the enforcement agencies or to the urban local body. So one area where I want to give a thrust is the, when you look into the city, there are, you see, there are two systems which are existing parallelly. One is the underground sewerage system network, and the other one is stormwater drain. Okay, the stormwater drain has to carry only storm water. That means only the rain water. But what we do, we don't take connections from the underground sewage scheme. We directly puncture that stormwater drain, which is close to our house. So it is not going to the underground sewerage system. The household domestic waste, the liquid waste, the sewage water, or it can be a sewage water, it is directly letting into the stormwater drain. What will happen if it goes to stormwater drain? All the stormwater drain networks are connected to it finally reaches to a nearest natural canal or drain or to the river. So whatever you are letting into the stormwater drain, that directly goes to the river. So when it goes to the river, naturally it goes to the sea. So make sure that there are a lot of opportunities given by campaigns done by the Metro Water. It's Adaithal Inaippu, Illandorum Inaippu. It is our responsibility not to let our sewage into the stormwater drain. We directly let into the, we'll get connected to the underground sewerage system. Okay. So what is the role of social work? As I said, the social worker have a lot of role in terms of environmental conservation, because the environment and social work are very relatively connected together. As a social worker, in all your field work practicum, as I said, there'll be field work opportunity, and there are NGOs like CRRT. You can do your concurrent field work, you can do your community organization program, and you can participate in the relocation camp, and you can take up your project work. You can adopt a water body which is close to your, if it is Kolam Creek or a part of the Buckingham Canal in Padur, which is close to your institution, and you can study it, and you can have a direct experience of having a wetland walk. Usually we have taken last year during the wetland day, we have taken the students of Madras School of Social Work they make them to walk from one particular the Thillaiyadivalliyam the co-optics bridge to the Munro bridge in Harrington Road to close to 1.2 kilometers. So that gives a direct experience to them and how the river reacts, how the river located just backside of your institution. So that's how you can map, you can do a resource mapping where you identify what all nearby, if any nearby waterways, water bodies. You can take up a field action for the project, like you can study this, take a baseline data about the how it operates and what is the community usage of the particular lake or a canal or a waterway or a creek, it is Muttukadu or a Kovalam Creek. So that will help you in terms of taking up a larger research, or you can devise a community organization programs with community participation in that particular area, because a lot of it is an area where in OMR there are many residential welfare associations are very active. Like your institution is also very active there. You can take up, you can adopt this particular, even government will be welcoming this act, because the whatever we do, this restoration scientifically, this can happen for one particular time. Later, after restoration, we want people to participate in terms of taking up this in terms of sustainable way to protect the restored ecosystem. Okay, and also you can, as a social worker, you have a lot of techniques in terms of the community participation techniques like PRA or a resource mapping, the transit walk that you can do in the nearby water body. Your thematic area should be water. Your thrust area can be water, means waterways or water body or any wetland. That will help you in terms of making yourself expertise in terms of the community participation in wetland restoration, right? So what we do, as I said, there's one other component of the CRRT is the community education program. We mapped the Kuvam River and we identified the institutions which are located 2 kilometer radius of right bank and left bank of the Kuvam River. And we regularly conduct the community education program. So this was rolled out in the year 2016 by then member secretary, respected Madam Kakarla Usha IAS. So Madam who rolled out this, now the chairman and managing director of Tamil Nadu Industrial Development Corporation. So Madam who was the who rolled out this campaign, we started in Madras School of Social Work. We invited the NSS coordinators and the social work department faculty members. And we had a day-long sensitization programs. And followed by that, we have program for the National Green Corps in schools, eco clubs in schools, the coordinator, teacher coordinators were called. And the first level, we had a sensitization program, even for ULBs, for the village panchayats, and for the urban local bodies, we had this program. And followed by that, there'll be a training of trainers workshop we did. And later, directly, we have gone to the schools. We identify the schools which are located on the banks of the Kuvam River. And we distribute pamphlets in English and Tamil. We have distributed the cloth bags with the message of saving the Kuvam River. And with the support of the cultural department of Loyola College, through Vailattam, Mailattam, Kolattam, Kuchiyattam, Karagattam, so different forms, the all forms with the message. That means the recreation with message, the message with the cultural program. Because when we sensitize a student, the student naturally take this message to the family. And when the family is sensitized, certainly the neighborhood gets sensitized of not polluting the Kuvam River or Adyar River to protect. So also the programs to the habitations, slum clearance board, the tenements on the Chindadripet and other areas. And there's one other program that we did this year. In February, first week is considered as a wetland week, the World Wetland Week. So then Member Secretary, respected Sir G. Prakash IAS, now the Commissioner, Greater Chennai Corporation. So he called all the zonal officers, the zonal team, the engineers of the zones which are located along the Kuvam and Adyar River. They called to Adyar Eco Park, and they have been given information about their role in terms of how to protect the Kuvam and Adyar River. So this is how the officials from the community to the school children at all level, the people are sensitized about the ongoing river restoration activity, which is taken up by the government. So what will be the indicators when the community productively and if they consciously involve in the restoration activity, certainly there will be improvement in the water quality and the biodiversity improves, and it will be a better living place, because now we are in a situation like COVID-19. And you could see the COVID-19 is basically, it's a SARS kind of a thing. It is SARI, so severe acute respiratory infection. So it affects the lung. That means when we have a healthy environment with a healthy oxygen enriched air, certainly our lungs, our vitals, our pulmonary system will be strengthened. If we have a better immunity, so we are in a position to tackle any kind of health emergency like COVID-19 comes. So that's where we need a place with you have an oxygen enriched area where because all these water bodies are basically the only lung space in the city. So we have to protect the lung space, the waterways and water bodies, and that will naturally protect us. When we protect environment will protect us. So the outcome of all the exercises with the community, so they should have a sense of ownership. We feel that the river which goes, which is close to our the place of living or your institution, where we should have a sense of ownership, not possession. You shouldn't take over the land. You should have a sense of ownership in terms of protecting this area. And certainly, if the protection can be given only by the community which is in the vicinity, in the closed area, so that will help in a very larger way. And our objective is the whatever government initiatives are taken in terms of restoration of the waterways, water bodies. We want the institutions like Hindustan College of Arts and Science and located very close to the waterways, water bodies. So they should have their share in terms of the sustainable protection of the water. Okay. So I know this is a marathon session where I have not given any pause in between because it's a I don't want to waste time and I have to give maximum inputs that what we do, because we do it's for last since 2008 the government is doing this, so to make it as a capsule to give you just an overview. So I have exploited 60 minutes of this time. Thank you. Thanks a lot for your patient listening and your interest. If you have any questions, if you have any further clarification, you can please put it in the chat box, or if you want to voice out, you can unmute and you can speak. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that wonderful presentation. I think it was totally elaborate right from the beginning, how it went on, and it ended with the role of social worker. So I think it was very good eye-opener for all the students over here, you know, who would have seen but didn't know how all this happened. Because when we really ask our previous generation, no, all these water bodies were used so effectively during a period of time, but mankind has done so. Now it is a responsibility of each and every person to do it. So we have some questions here, sir. So there is one question from a student. He's asking, is it right to relocate slums as people might lose their livelihood? That is a question what he is posing. So what is your response?
Yes. So that's how I've taken time to elaborate about the resettlement rehabilitation. So it is inevitable, because when the river needs its own place to have, so it is, we are not relocating people who are beyond the right of way. So river should have its own, water flowing area. Without that, whenever there is if any monsoon comes or if any calamity like 2015 flood comes where, so that's how we didn't care about the river, and the river needs its place to accommodate the flood water. So that is the need for to relocate the people. So we make sure that this happens seamlessly, because it is without people participation, in my experience in the last 5 years here, so there are still habitations which they don't want to move out from this place. They don't want to relocate from the place, because that's how it takes time, because the nature had taken its own time to convince the people. Because if the people, we didn't see this 2015 kind of flood, where we don't feel the importance of the water body in the city. You see the density of population in city, we are a very highly dense area. Where we have to restore this water body. So there is no other go. So that is one. And we make sure we are very sensitive in terms of, we make sure the government is very meticulously planning this to relocate the family. Because if there is no untoward incident, or we are not forcibly relocating anything, we do maximum. Because as I said, the unit, for every dwelling units, now it's cost 13 lakh. You see, you get an allotment in slum clearance board is not easy. And we make sure that in addition to that, we provide all the rehabilitation measures, shifting expense, shifting allowance, subsistence allowance is given to them. And the project management group and they make sure that they get all the benefits and entitlements. Okay, this is what I said. It's only the from the government part. In addition to that, there are a lot of the non-governmental organizations which are working in the scheme area. In addition to that, they also give additional benefits to them. There is one thing that I'd like to highlight during this time. When our member secretary Prakash sir during the in March, we felt that the people are relocated people in Perumbakkam, other schemes, they don't have livelihood for more than 3 to 4 months at particular time, because it is a COVID time. So the subsistence allowance of 2,500, which is given in a monthly basis, it is disbursed on a monthly basis to the bank account. So the we made a proposal, and the member secretary requested the MD slum clearance, but he said, so this is a very critical time. So anyway, the 30,000 is given to them. It is entitled to them. Anyway, they are going to get this 30,000 in a month, 12 months period of time. Why can't we give 2 months or 2 months, 5,000 at a one stretch to the relocated family? So the TNSCB is kind enough to consider. They dispose 3 months amount, 7,500 rupees to 2,300 families. You imagine the cost which is involved. You see, it is close to 2 crore is disposed to them. So that's how the government is very sensitive in terms of relocating the ensuring that the rehabilitation happens too.
Thank you, sir. Actually, this is a very wide topic. I think yes, even that is not enough.
Yes,
because
ma'am.
A lot of sensitive issues, psychological aspects, social aspect, economical aspects, a combination of all.
Yes,
because of the time constraint, I think you can contact sir the
yes,
number, email ID he has shared. So whatever the questions you can have, you can ask sir, or you can send it to us in the Telegram group also. We'll send it to sir and we'll get it.
Sure, ma'am.
So I'm very grateful to you, very thankful to Mr. Social expert come information and communication specialist, CRRT. So I'm very happy that he's my alumni. We are from the same college. He's my junior. So I'm very happy and very proud to have you as the resource person for this session on river restoration and wetland conservation. So this, the main reason why we arranged this webinar is because the social worker's role is very important. So this presentation has really given a very clear insight and information of what is the role of social worker in river restoration and wetland conservation. Definitely, we'll also involve into a lot of activities because we have Buttukad Lake just behind our college. So we'll also take some activities related to that. And of course, we need a lot of advice on you regarding this, to how to carry out some activities, field action projects, especially by our undergraduate students and postgraduate students. So I thank all the wonderful participants, because in the beginning I told you have to mute yourself and perfect discipline. So we didn't have any kind of disturbance, and it very, very beautifully they listened to the entire session, and I could see still they are posting a lot of questions. So that showed how much interest they have shown to this program. So on behalf of Hindustan College, I extend my heartfelt thanks to all the participants here from the various part of the country and the state. So thank you for joining for this webinar. I want to thank my colleague, Mr. Jonas Samuel, Mrs. Jasmine Bernard, and Mrs. Lena Rostin, who was a part of this webinar, and for all the support. And I want to congratulate the STEPS Forum, the students, because the first program in 2020 for bringing such a wonderful social work program. And all the best and best wishes for many more programs to be done under STEPS. As Mr. Jain shared about the force, because that is the power of a students forum. No, even Madras Social School of Social Work, the forum was so active, and that really trained us to become a more professional. So I think this STEPS forum is going to go many more steps in this 2020. So let me wish all the students of Department of Social Work, Hindustan College, and all the social work students all over the other colleges. So thank you for joining. I once again extend a very heartfelt thanks to Mr. Jayant, and looking forward for many more sessions on
thank you, ma'am.
Development and other activities. So thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.